539. Number 559.
Good morning. This is Elijah Gilbert speaking for the Church of Christ. We welcome you to our worship service. We appreciate our radio and TV audience and invite you to worship with us whenever possible. Our building is located at 4th and Magnolia in South Pittsburgh. Our visitors are asked to fill out a visitor's card located on the back of the pew. Please drop this in the collection plate when it is passed. We meet each Sunday at 9 a.m. and 6 p.m. for worship. We have Bible classes for all ages following our morning worship service. We also meet on Wednesday at 7 p.m. for Bible study. The purpose of the Church of Christ is to uphold the Bible as the Word of God and to exalt Christ as the Son of God. We urge all to become Christians in the New Testament way. A CD or DVD of today's sermon is available free upon request by calling 837-6088. Others serving in the worship today are Marion Greider, who is directing our singing. The opening prayer will be led by Johnny Holman. Our speaker today is Ron Gilbert, and the closing prayer will be led by Harold Greider. Other announcements are, today, the youth devotional will be at 5 p.m. Starting today through the 25th, the gospel meeting will begin at Cowan, and September the 28th through October the 1st, our gospel meeting with Wesley Simons. dinner after Sunday school, group two is in charge. We have a thank you note here which reads, "Thank you all for the food, cards, and especially thoughts and prayers. It all means so much to all of us. Please keep Jim and Mom in your prayers, David and Frida Jones." Check the bulletin for a list of the sick of the congregation, and please add the following: Michael Denton has been diagnosed with pneumonia. We will now have the opening prayer.
Let us pray. Our Almighty God in heaven, we come to you at this time thanking you for all the many blessings you've given us. Father, we're thankful for this day that you've allowed us to gather together as a church family and worship you in spirit and in truth. Father, we're so thankful that we're able to come together and sing these songs of praise to your name. Help us to listen to the messages that are in the songs. We're thankful for the preaching that we're going to hear. Help us to focus on the message that Ron will be bringing to us as well. We're also thankful that we are allowed to come to you in prayer and express our thoughts and our needs and concerns to you. We're so thankful, Father, that you've allowed us these opportunities that we have. We're thankful, Father, for Jesus Christ, who came to this earth and lived as a man and set the right example for us to follow. We're so thankful that he was able to live a sinless life and that he shed his blood on the cross for our sins. We pray, Father, that all would take advantage of that blood and come to him in obedience and serve him throughout their lives. We pray, Father, for our nation. We pray, Father, for our leaders. We ask that you would bless them and help them to do those things that would be most beneficial to our country. Pray, Father, that they would look to you for guidance, look to you for strength to have the courage to stand up against the evils of the world. We pray, Father, that you would be with the people who are working in mission fields. We ask, Father, that the seed would be sown and it would land upon good and honest hearts, and many would obey the gospel because of their efforts. We're thankful, Father, for those who have been prayers that have been answered on behalf of the sick. We ask at this time that you would be with Michael Denton as he's suffering from pneumonia. Pray, Father, that his body would fight the infection and he would be able to be recovered fully. Pray for others who are sick, Father, at this time. Pray for you be with David Jones and others that I don't know about and that might need your help. We ask, Father, that you just continue to be with us and help us to clear our minds of the activities of the day and stay focused on you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Song this morning, but number 89.
number 89.
Good morning, brethren. Good to see everybody. Looks like we're missing a few today, but it sure is good to see you. We're glad that you're here. Appreciated the opportunity that was allotted me to be able to have a gospel meeting last week in the group lead logger community up on Grundy County, and you will not find a more German name than that, will you? Group lead logger, even the way it's spelled. But enjoyed that, and I tell you what, you're talking about a little congregation that could sure give us a goal. The average attendance, I'd say, on Sunday morning is somewhere between 9 and 13. And yet, the average attendance of that gospel meeting was well over 40, so I'd say 44, 45. Imagine if we would put four times as many people in this building next week as we have here on a normal Sunday. Might be crowded, but I sure would like to hear the singing, wouldn't you, Harold? But I certainly do appreciate being back home. It's good to see everyone. And I was thinking about the fine men that helped in leading us this morning in worship and our announcements and so forth. We're so fortunate to have so many that are talented to be able to do these things. Appreciate Marion leading that song, one of my favorite songs. And as I get older, that song becomes even more precious to me as I realize how many more people I know are there waiting for me to get home and sing a few songs with them as the days go by. I love that song. Appreciate all of our men here. You don't realize how much you appreciate that. Sunday, the song leader was having to work up there. The preacher was hoarse and could not do it, and so I was afforded the opportunity to lead the singing as well as preach. But I certainly enjoyed it. And he said some Sundays he has to lead the singing and preach and lead the prayers and a lot of times do the Lord's Supper as well. And I said, hey, been there and done that. It is a great growing experience, and I'm thankful for men like himself who are willing to do that. I know of two congregations in the valley, in the Sequatchie Valley, that one has already closed their doors this year, and another is very heavily contemplating that. And brethren, that's what will happen if we don't have good men that are willing to sacrifice their time and so forth to put forth the effort to learn how to do the various things that need to be done. And are willing to do it. And I'm very thankful that we have men here that will do just that. I'd like to draw your attention this morning to something that I reflect on from time to time, and I'm sure that you do. And that is why many are not saved. When I think about all the blessings that we have in Christ Jesus, the very first thing that comes to my mind is Ephesians chapter 1. Paul will say that we have all these spiritual blessings, all spiritual blessings, are in Christ Jesus. In other words, are in the church, are in the body of Christ. And we as Christians, of course, are fortunate enough to be recipients of these blessings. And I always want to make sure I have my cell phone turned off. I probably need to start reminding people to do that. Up in Gatlinburg, when you go to church up there, they have a thing on the screen. It tells you to silence your cell phones. I always think maybe I'm at the movie theater. You know, they tell you to do the same. But the reason I say that, Tuesday night, we were, halfway done with the meeting, and all of a sudden a phone rang in the back, and this lady had to dig through her pocketbook, and I asked her to let me answer it. But she wouldn't. I thought we could have had one more person at the meeting there that night. We could have talked to them on the cell phone. But this day and age in which we live, a lot of folks nowadays bring their Bible to church that way. I think that's a great thing. But also, it's not a very great thing when it rings and it embarrasses you. But the heavenly places is where all of our blessings are in Christ Jesus. Paul will also say that we have been accepted in the Beloved. Think of the terminology that's used to talk about Christians. He'll say, in whom we have redemption through his blood. As Christians, we walk in the light, we are saved. We are walking around in a saved condition as long as we are walking in the light. If we were to get hit by a bus, it would be okay. Because we're going to leave this earth and we're going to go and we're going to be with all those singers that have already gone home. We have great reason to rejoice. We have so much to be thankful for. And I am very thankful indeed for that. In verse 8, he says, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence, having made known unto us the mystery. Isn't it great to know something that was held a mystery for thousands of years? that the Gentile and the Jew would both be reconciled into the body of Christ. That mystery, Paul begins in Ephesians chapter 1 and will continue through chapter 2 and 3 and say that this mystery is that the Jew and the Gentile will both be brought into one in the Christ. Verse 13 in Ephesians 1, he'll say, "In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard of the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise." A down payment, if you will. Oh, yes, as we walk in the light as Christians, we have salvation in Christ. We are brothers and sisters. We have a tremendous bond that goes above all things. And think of what Jesus asks us to do. To keep his commandments, which are not grievous. He asked us to walk in the light like he walked. And what a great life he had. When men asked him what to do to be saved, he would tell them what to do to be saved. He wouldn't pull no punches, but in love. And he would help them do that very thing. Jesus loved men. He asked me and you to do the same. I don't know about you, but I think I would have a hard time following Jesus if he told me that I needed to pull out my pocket knife and get on the internet and cut people's heads off. I would just have a problem with that. I would not think that that's a good thing to do. You see, I was raised differently than that, that you don't kill innocent people. Yet we have a world religion today that promotes that type of activity and, as a matter of fact, makes these the great martyrs of their religion. The Lord Jesus doesn't ask us to do anything but to help our fellow man. If we were to accidentally hurt someone, the Lord tells us we need to help them. You'll remember when Peter, when his Lord was being arrested, pulled out his sword, cut off a fellow's ear, and Jesus told him to put his sword up and then went to heal the fellow's ear. It's absolutely amazing. How anyone could not love the Savior, could not want to be like him, is beyond me. But the fact of the matter is, most people will be lost. That was something that was kind of hard for me to get my rope around, I guess you could say. I believe in the Old Testament, the one verse that if you can get on top of it, come to understand it and believe it, makes everything easier in the rest of the Old Testament, has to be Genesis 1 at 1. In the beginning, God created the heavens. You know, anything on the other side of that, if I could accept that and come to grips with that, I'm not going to run across anything else that's going to be more miraculous or outstanding than that. God created the heaven and the earth. I believe in the New Testament, these two verses we're fixing to look at here, Matthew 7:13-14, are the hard to get over passages. If you can accept them, come to understand what they're saying, it makes the rest of the New Testament a lot easier to understand. Matthew 7:13, Jesus, now this is the end of the Sermon on the Mount, the longest recorded sermon of our Lord, the one in which he talks about being the light of the world, talks about the Beatitudes and how we ought to be inwardly and see how lacking we are on so many of those things. But blessed are the peacemakers, blessed are the meek. You know all the Beatitudes. We're going to be a great light. Talks about the old covenant had been interpreted to this, but I say unto you, and gives us not necessarily new information, but expounds upon the attitude that a Christian must have. Then in chapter 7, he starts talking about judging. Then he talks about wolves in sheep's clothing. And then in verse 13, "Enter ye in at the straight gate. Wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction. Many there be which go in thereat." Notice the two words we're going to have to describe. Many are going to be lost. Many are going to go into that wide gate that leadeth to destruction, the broad path. But notice verse 14. "Because straight or narrow is the gate, and narrow is the way which leadeth unto life." And notice the few. "And few there be that find it." I know when I was in denominational error and I would read this verse, I would think about how the few there, even though I knew a lot of people who were in the same era that I was in, I thought surely there'd be some way. You know, surely God is going to surely. No, this passage says, just take it right off the top. Many are going to be lost. Few there's going to be to say be saved. He'll say later in verse 21 that many will say unto him, "Lord, Lord," you know, in that day. And ultimately he'll say, "Depart from me, I never knew you." Why was that? Because they didn't do what God said. They didn't do the will of the Father. And that's when I realized pretty early on that I needed to figure out what God had said and not men. Because one of the arguments that was made to me right off the first, when I started looking at the Bible and seeing that some of the things it were saying, it was saying, was contrary to what I was taught, was when I was taught that ask the Lord Jesus to come into your heart and save you as your personal Savior. I was taught that, and I just knew that that was in the Bible. And I had a man that told me, he says, that's not in the Bible. You won't find it anywhere. And I thought, well, that fella right there is full of blue mud. I've heard that my whole life. I know it's in there. So I went home, and I commenced searching for it. And you know what? It was not there. And so I called some people to try to get ammunition, you know, to go back in this war I was losing. And said, you know, where is that? Well, it's not there. But in principle. And I said, but in principle. And see, what I was arguing against was Mark 16:16. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. And I said, that seems pretty simple to me. He says, believe and baptism. Now, how do I get just faith only out of that? Well, they'd say, in principle. I said, how do you take principle and trump what's clearly stated? That's not principle. That's belief in baptism. Now, why? First of all, why would we even argue against that? And I wasn't given an answer satisfactory to my understanding. And that's why I said, you know what? I think I need to go with the Bible. Because the Bible seems to be telling me that a lot of folks are going to be lost. And very few are going to find it. But he that doeth the will of the Father. Why many are not? Well, there's many reasons why people will be lost. A variety of circumstances. Have you ever just sat down sometimes and contemplated those circumstances? And I realize that's a big thing to look at. But I have thought, and I've heard good brethren pray, and I have prayed myself, and I am so thankful that I was born in Tennessee in the United States of America, and all the Alabama people just dropped their heads. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about in the southeastern United States, in the Bible Belt, from what I heard as a little child on up, that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that the Bible was his word. I am thankful for that because I am not the sharpest tool in the shed. And sometimes you got to pound things into me before I get it. But that's one thing. Even growing up in a family that was not religious, even going to places that were not religiously oriented and not you know, having any kind of church life, I knew who Jesus Christ was. I knew that there was a God in heaven, and I knew that the Bible was his word. And then when I went to a place that taught me denominational error, they still taught me that Jesus was the Christ, that God was in heaven, and that the Bible was his word. You see, I had that ingrained into me. And I think, what would have happened had I grown up or was born in India? And all I saw day in and day out was one idol after another idol after another idol after another idol. People bringing bananas and raisins and so forth and laying them down in the hands and palms and feet of these idols. If you ever get to go to the temple up in Nashville, you'll see that. Having them draw that shower curtain across that idol a couple hours every day while they clean that thing and remove all that food and stuff, because that idol ain't going to eat that food. No, that's eaten, of course, by the priests or so forth, or thrown out or whatever. You see, that idol couldn't do anything. But if I had been taught from a little bitty feller that that's how you did it and that's what religion was all about, or if I had grown up where I went into this big, fancy, ornate building, you know, sometimes on Saturday night, sometimes on Sunday, depending whenever the Mass was, and had all these idols laying around, and that you're supposed to kiss towards this one and say a prayer toward that one, rubbing your beads and holding your necklace, and every time you go up to bat, be sure and cross yourself and rub your little, your saint, whatever, necklace there. Is that what I would have believed? I'm very thankful for the circumstances wherein which I grew up. You got to be a lover of the truth. We have our own challenges in this country, just like people in other countries have their own challenges. And we're going to see that one of the things you got to do to be a Christian is that you're going to have to love truth. And when truth comes against error, they won't mix, kind of like oil and vinegar. You know, you might shake them up a little bit, and they might look like they're mixing, but you let it sit there for a minute, and it's going to separate. They don't mix. And I would like to think that had I been born in one of these other nations or in a different circumstance, that my love of truth would still have won out. But I don't know. I don't know that. I thank God for that. And I tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to raise up my children in the nurture and admonition of the Lord and try to help raise up my grandchildren in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. I'm not going to try raising them up around pagans and teaching them other things. You know, I don't want to see how it's going to work out. I want to help them out all I can, a variety of circumstances. But the rest of the time we have, I want to look at a few of these reasons. And I know that you could add any more. This is just me sitting around thinking, which can be dangerous. Why many are not saved? Number one, they don't think they're lost. Either they think they're above sin or they think there is no sin. They're atheists and say, you know, you're holding me to some standard that doesn't even exist. After all, we're just bugs. And we have these laws so we don't lose personal property and things of that nature. But there's no such thing as God. I'm not lost. But, you know, there's even religious people, very devout religious people, that don't see any need whatsoever for the Christ, don't see any need whatsoever for being saved. We meet some of these in the first century in John chapter 8. Jesus is speaking with them. He says, then said Jesus to those Jews which believed on him. Now notice they saw the works. They heard the teaching. And what did they say? That man's the Christ. He is the one. See, they had a different understanding of what the Christ was, the Messiah was. But notice, he says, if you continue in my word, then ye are my disciples indeed. Verse 8:32, most of us could quote it. And ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. Now they were like, oh, wait a minute. What do you mean by that? They answered him and said, we be Abraham's seed, and never into bondage to any man. You see, we were born, God made the covenant with Abraham. We're his children. We're not sinners. No, we're the chosen ones. What are you talking about? We are in need of being free. We've never been in bondage to any man. Of course, they meant that in a spiritual sense. They're not talking about a physical sense. At that very moment, they were under bondage to the Romans. They'd been under bondage to the Babylonians. Some of them had been in bondage to the Assyrians. And as a group, they'd been in bondage to Egypt. So they're not talking about that. They're talking about sinless. We don't need to be freed from sins. We're God's people. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? When our high priest goes into the Holy of Holies and gives that blood of the covenant, gives that blood of the sacrifice on the Day of Atonement, we're free from sin. What do you mean bondage to sin? They didn't understand the fact they were doing that every year, looking forward to the time when Christ would come, give himself as a ransom for many, offer up his sacrifice once and for all time. They didn't look to that. They thought, hey, listen, we don't need you. We shall be made free. What do you mean by that? Jesus answered them, truly, truly, or verily, verily, I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is a servant of sin. Look at your life. Look at how you're living. Look how you steal widows' houses and you mistreat the orphans and the blood that's on your hands, as we're going to see tonight in Ezekiel. They said one thing, but they did another. They said they loved God more than anything else, but their lives did not show that. That's one of the reasons Jesus was having to say, whoso looketh on a woman to lust after, because they had read, well, thou shalt not commit adultery. That doesn't mean you can't think about it. Doesn't mean every time you see a woman you'd like to have, you can't, you know, play with it in your mind. Jesus said it's a heart condition. And they had done so much of that with the law. I had the privilege of just this past week reading a great deal of what's called the Jewish Mishnah. It is the oral tradition written down, which is kind of funny if you think about it. But they had to write it down because it was so involved, and they were getting to the point where they were forgetting a lot of it. So around the second century, they wrote it down. And you ought to hear how these men talk about oaths and things of this nature. It's all legal mumbo jumbo. And you get lost in what's even said about it. And instead of the heart is where it all begins. And basically, Jesus is saying, you know, you need to fix your heart. You need to circumcise your heart, not your flesh. Because they circumcise the flesh, say, good, we're good to go. It's how a lot of brethren, I think, perceive baptism today. They think once they've had their ticket punched, they can live their lives any way they want. Not so. Jesus says you need to fix your life. Well, they thought they'd never been under bondage to any man. Jesus says you're sinning. You're a servant of sin. You need to clean it up. Many are not saved because they simply don't believe. They do not believe in the Christ. You start talking to them about creation, about the God of heaven, and they laugh at you. They scoff. You're talking about some bearded fella sitting up in high places somewhere, throwed all this together. Yeah, right. And they just scoff. But you know, there were many in Jesus' day the same way. Notice Jesus talks about those of us who sow the seed, who preach the gospel, who teach. This could be you. This is me. When we go out into the communities, to the people that we rub elbows with in the workforce, to those that we play with on the playground, those that we have class with in school, He says, those by the wayside are they that hear. Now listen, they're hearing the same message you and I heard when we obeyed the gospel. They're listening to the Bible. Then cometh the devil. Notice there's another party involved here. And taketh away the word out of their hearts. How does the devil work? Well, he doesn't run in there and actually physically grab something out of their heart. But he works through guys like, well, Robert Ingersoll. He works through these great scientists, so forth and everything, who would like to tell you there's proof that there is no God, yet there's no proof of what they say. They cannot scientifically prove creation. They cannot scientifically prove origins. And yet they want to tell us there's no God. And that's one of the tools that the devil uses to snatch the word from men's heart. A counter argument, if you will. Oh, here's how we got here. It's just nothing but biology. It's nothing but evolution, and we're just here by time and chance. But see, there's a lot of baggage that comes along with that even our atheist friends don't like. You think they like all the shootings that are going on? You think they like how people will kill each other over enough money to get high off of? No, they see, too, that there's a problem with that, but they don't know how to fix it. Brethren, we know how. And we ought to be teaching and preaching and helping people to understand there is a God in heaven, that they have a soul, and that it's the most beautiful part of their existence, and that they need to take care of it, and that men are created in the image of God, and that we don't need to disrespect each other, much less kill each other or harm each other. That's what's wrong with the world. Notice the devil takes the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. John 8:24, Jesus said, I said, therefore unto you, that ye shall die in your sins. For if you believe not that I am he, ye shall die in your sins. Here Jesus is talking to Jewish people who do not believe that he's the Christ. And he's trying to convince them that he is. And he's saying, if you don't believe that I am he, you will die in your sins. But here's how the devil works, folks. The devil comes in the form of a preacher standing in front of a congregation who says, those Jews out there are all right. They're saved. As a matter of fact, they're Abraham's seed. And if anybody's going to heaven, it's going to be them. And they teach millennial theology, as we say, where they believe Jesus is going to come back and reign for 1,000 years in the physical city of Jerusalem. And they give people hope where there is no hope. They give Jews hope today and say, listen, you don't have to believe in Jesus. You're the chosen. You're under a different covenant. Don't worry about that, folks. That's the devil. Because Jesus, talking to the very people who these preachers today are speaking to, says, unless you come to grips with the fact that I am he, you are going to be lost in your sins. And how does the devil work? He sends other people to preach and teach something different. Mark 16:16, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. You've got to believe. Hebrews 11:6, but without faith, impossible to please him. Notice, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. Many will be lost because they do not believe. Many will be lost because they're trusting in faith only. In James 2 at verse 22. Now I know you've heard that. I've heard that. I heard that growing up my whole life. Just believe that Jesus is the Christ. You'll be saved. Then you can go about doing those other things. Notice what James says. Talking about Abraham. He says, seest thou how faith wrought with his works? And by works was faith made perfect. Now this word wrought comes from a Greek word that is synergio. And soon it just means with, ergo is where we get our word ergonomics, means to work. And so you have with and work. And the definition is to be a fellow worker. That is one that cooperates together. And so we don't wrought a whole lot today. We don't use that word. So that's why I like the English Standard Version a little bit easier here. It brings it in our modern day vernacular, I think. You see that faith was active. It was doing something. It was working along with. That's the idea. Faith working along with what? His works. And faith was completed or made whole by his works. You can't separate the two. Our denominational friends were upset because for 1,000 years the Popish Church out of Rome taught that works, this is what you've got to do. Martin Luther looked at that and said, no, I don't believe that's right. I believe it's by faith. And so they contrasted the two and made them where they don't fit together, where the Bible says you got to have one and you have to have the other. You've got that which is done by God, grace, but man has his part. And it's his works with his faith working together. Notice how this is encapsulated, if you will, in verse 24. You see then how that by works a man is justified and not by faith only. And notice it doesn't say works only or works alone. Anytime you go sticking a word alone behind something in the Bible that God didn't put there, you better watch out. It's not blood alone, not grace alone, not faith alone, not works alone, not baptism alone, not repentance alone. None of those alone. It takes it all working together. By faith, Noah, being warned of God of things is not yet. Didn't just say, hey, I believe that God, and sat there till it started raining. No. Moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became the heir of righteousness, which is by faith. Matthew 7:21, we alluded to this earlier. Jesus said, not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, but notice, he that doeth the will of my Father, works and faith, working together. Hebrews 5:8, Jesus, though he were a son, yet learned he obedience by the things which he suffered, and being made perfect, complete, became the captain or the leader of our eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Many are not saved. And brethren, we just need to come to grips with this. Some people just love sin. They love their dope. They love their drunkenness. They love their alcohol. They love their adultery. They love their fornication. They love their gambling. There's just things that they love more than they love God. And I know sometimes as parents, sometimes as grandparents, that's sometimes as our friends, we just... that's hard for us to get. But let's just, you know, muscle up there and understand some people are like that. We've got to try to help them get out of that, but it is the fact some just simply love sin. And this is the condemnation, that light is coming to the world. Now, this is right after John 3:16, a few verses. And men love darkness rather than light. We'd like to think that all men, boy, once they see that Jesus is the Christ and that he has a church and that he'll buy us back, he'll redeem us when we obey the gospel, he'll add us to the church, the body of the saved. We'd like to think that all people say, yip, yip, hi, that's great. Let's, you know what, show me how. But you got a lot of people just not willing to give up the things that make up their life. They're not willing to give up their lifestyle, which is contrary to the will of God. Sometimes people are working their way out of these things. They need help, they need time. And then sometimes people just say, I'm not doing it. 2 Timothy 3:1, this know also that in the last days perilous times shall come, for men shall be lovers of their own selves. That's where it comes down to. It is selfishness. I like this, and I'm going to stay with this. Notice they love themselves to the exclusion of loving their family, loving their children. This without natural affection mentioned two times in the New Testament. Both times it's without natural affection. It is that affection that a parent ought to have for his child or her child. It is something that is innate. And when it's not there, there's something wrong. There's some wires crossed somewhere. Because the Bible says that's natural affection. A couple get together, they have a baby, they should love that baby. That's natural. That's the way it should go. But notice what happens in these last days. Men shall lovers of their own selves. And what's going to happen as a result of that? It's going to hurt sometimes to the just getting rid of that natural affection that they should have. And you're going to have the situation that we have today where people are saying, listen, I know that I ought to be a better person. I know that I ought to have my family in church. I realize that I am the spiritual head of my family. But you know what? I like this better. And besides, I had to come about, you know, doing things my own self. Let them figure it out themselves. Whereas I know a lot of people, Wesley Simons will be starting our meeting next Sunday. One of the things that motivated him to get right with God was a little baby girl. Had that first child, and he looked at his wife and said, you know what? We've got to get right. We've got to get right so that we can show this baby girl how to be right and give her the example, because now it's just not mine and your soul. It's hers as well. You see, that's what natural affection will bring a person to do, a parent to do. But when you love yourself more than you do anything or everything around you, you're going to lack this quality. Love not the things in the world you've got. And I'm not saying you don't love the earth. There's a precious waterfall you like to go to, or mountain air. No, those are natural things. That's not what this passage is talking about. It's talking about those things in the world, the sin and so forth, the apart from Christian, you know, walking in the light, walking in darkness, the worldly things. Because the love of the Father is not in you. For all that is in the world, the lust of the flesh. Notice he enumerates what he's talking about. Lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, the pride of life, not of the Father, it is of the world, and the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of God abideth forever. Many are not saved, because they're trusting in morality. Folks, I know this because there have been people near and dear to me and my family. They're gone on now. But this is how they lived their life. And this is how they died. They kind of thought it's going to be like this. It's going to be a balance scale there. And all your good deeds are going to be put on one side and all your bad deeds on the other. And if your good deeds outweigh those bad, you're going to be all right. That's why you ought to always tell the truth, be a good person, you know, morally, right down the line. But is that what the Bible says? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The wages of sin is what? Death. One sin. You see, if morality could save us, Jesus wouldn't have had to die on the cross. Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father. You can't get to God without Jesus. And you can't have Jesus unless you obey his commandments and obey the gospel. If you love me, John 14:15, keep my commandments. It's pretty cut and dry. Many are not saved because they love the praise of men. One of the saddest accounts in Scripture. Nevertheless, among the chief rulers, people high up, believed on Christ, but because of the Pharisees, would not confess him because they were afraid of being put out of the church at that time, the synagogue. For they loved the praise of men. You see, they'd much rather be appreciated and lifted up and boasted about by their next door neighbor than they would the very God of heaven. There's some folks like that. Many men will be lost as a result of that. Many are not going to be saved because they're biased. They look at a situation and they will not examine the truth. They will not look at what the Bible says, but they'll take what they've been taught and they'll say, listen, this is what I believe, and you're not. Remember a fellow lady one time talking to a friend of mine, and she was giving him down the road about his diet because she believed in dietary restraints. She was giving him down the road because the day he worshipped on, because she worshipped on another. And he said, well, what do you think about this passage on divorce and remarriage? She said, I know that's what it says, but I don't believe it. You see, she's willing to take that Bible everywhere it walked in line with her. You think she might have been biased? I believe so. And why? Because she was not a lover of the truth. Notice what Jesus says. These people's heart is waxed gross, their ears are dull of hearing, they won't listen. Their eyes they have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes, hear with their ears, understand with their heart, and shouldn't be converted, and I could heal them. They won't do it. They've chosen not to. Many are not saved because they're blind, no love of the truth. Talking about the Pharisees, Jesus said, let them alone, they be blind leaders of the blind. You can't help them. They're blind, and if blind lead the blind, they shall both fall into the ditch. Here you had these people just following these folks anywhere they would go. This idea is described in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10 beginning. And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish, because, here's the kicker, they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved. They didn't receive it. And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie, that they all might be damned who believe not the truth. Why did they not believe the truth? Because they had pleasure in unrighteousness. They chose us, and I'm not going to look at that. I'm having too much fun over here. They didn't love the truth, and they're not going to be saved as a result. Many are not saved because they're unfaithful, simply unfaithful. They have not added the Christian graces, which I cheated and put the abbreviations up there if you want to go with them. Faith, virtue, knowledge, temperance, patience, godliness, brotherly kindness, and the last one we'd probably change from a C to an L, because it's talking about love. They haven't done that. Peter said, you do these, you shall never fall. Failed to bear fruit. Remember what Jesus said about the vines that didn't bear fruit? They were going to be digged up, and where were they going to be cast out, burnt? They failed to bear fruit, and the worst. Turn with me, if you will. I know we're pushed for time, but look with me, if you will, at 2 Peter chapter 2. If you don't have this marked out in your Bible, I hope all of y'all have a phone or something, because I don't hear any pages turning. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 12, maybe you have this memorized. Notice, for if after they have escaped the pollutions of the world. Notice, whoever we're talking about here has escaped the pollutions of the world. How do you do that? Through Jesus Christ. It even says, through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What are these folks? They're saved. They're saved. They are again entangled therein and overcome. The latter end is worse for them than from the beginning. Doesn't say a lot. For once saved, always saved, does it? For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness. Guess what they knew? Yes, the way of righteousness. than after they have known it to turn away from the holy commandment delivered unto them. And then he gives us those proverbial statements that kind of describe that action. But it has happened unto them according to the true proverb, the dog is turned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire. That's the condition of a Christian who's become unfaithful, who's gone back into the way of the world. We don't want to do that. Why many are not saved? They have secret skepticism. What do I mean about that? They get to looking at the Bible, and they go, man, I don't know about that. You know, Darwinism says this. My science teachers say that, you know, this couldn't possibly have been done in 6 days, that we needed billions of years. And it looks throughout all these scientific studies that I'm reading and seeing that all this seems to be right against what the Bible. And they got all these books saying Bible's wrong. And they look at their Bible, and they're like, you know what? It just might be wrong. And they do like Thomas Jefferson and say, well, you know, I like all the moral principles and stuff that are in there. I think Jesus, man, he was a good fella. Taught a lot of great things. I'm going to stick with what Jesus taught, but I'm going to cut out these miracles and things like that because that's over the top for me. A lot of people act like that, have over the past. Thomas Jefferson went through and cut his Bible up. You can see it on display today. Called the Jeffersonian Bible. Took the miracles out. Of course, he had some problems there, too, with the American Indians. He was worried about the miraculous, how they would interpret all that. But you have people that do that, and they get embarrassed. I'll never forget Phil Donahue talking to a fellow from the Memphis School of Preaching, Garland Elkins, and because he thought he had Garland. Garland had been quoting scripture after scripture, talking about this woman who was called, and she was in an adulterous situation. The church had fired her. Because she was the secretary, you know, something legal problems that came along with that. But, Phil would ask him about that, and he'd tell him straight up. Of course, you know, Phil had multiple marriages by that time. So he thought he had old Garland. I'll never forget it. Because he asked Garland, he said, well, do you believe in the big whale? You know, in other words, do you believe in that big fish story? And Garland said, absolutely. I believe that's exactly what the Bible says. And I wish Garland had more opportunity because I know he could have fired right back at Phil and said, you believe in Jesus, don't you? And I know Phil would have said, oh, yes, you know, I believe in Jesus. Well, notice what Jesus said. What did Jesus teach? He taught the big fish story, didn't he? As a matter of fact, he says, for as Jonas, change that to Jonah, that's how most of the newer versions do anyway, it's what he's talking about. For as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the whale's belly, what's he saying? That what the prophet Jonah wrote was true. And the Son of God, through inspiration, I mean, he is God. He's speaking that Jonah's story is true. So shall the Son of Man be 3 days, three nights in the heart of the earth. He's talking about his death, his burial, and his resurrection. And he's applying it as he's coming from. He's using the story of Jonah to show that. Notice in Matthew 10:15, verily I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable than for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah in the day of judgment. Yes, Jesus believed in Genesis 19 and that God eradicated an entire populace there because of the wickedness of the cities. And yes, he believed in creation. How do I know that? In Matthew 19:4, he answered them. Remember, they're saying, is it lawful for a man to put away his wife for every cause? They're trying to catch Jesus in something. What does he appeal to? Have ye not read that he which made them at the beginning of what? The beginning of it all, friends. The first day, the second day, the 6 days of creation, what did he make, male and female? And that's exactly what Jesus is appealing to. So when you have people who are kind of, they want to make fun of you and I for believing the big fish story. They want to hold on to Jesus. You can't have that. You can't have that. No, if you're going to hold on to Jesus, you're going to have to hold on to the big fish story and the 6 days of creation because that's what God said took place. Many are not saved. They won't even take the time to investigate. They won't look. Jesus says, search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they which testify of me. He says, search them. He says, you talk about, hey, we got to be saved by the Bible. The Bible is the word of God. He says, look in it. Brethren, we talk and preach the same thing today, do we not? As members of the Lord's church, this is the word of God. How many of us know it? How many of us spend time with it? How many of us take the time to truly investigate it for ourselves? Notice those in Berea were called more noble than those in Thessalonica. Why? They opened up the book. They looked at the scriptures to make sure what Paul was saying was so. Many are not saved, because they trust in their feelings. You know, there's a popular denomination today, started by Joseph Smith back in the middle of the 1800s, has gone on to become the Mormon Church. They'll tell you straight up that if you got a problem, you're trying to figure out whether you ought to believe the Bible or the Book of Mormon or both, that you ought to pray about it. That you ought to pray about it and then go with your feelings. God will make your feelings that, folks, that's not a good, your conscience is not a good guide in things where you're not trained. What do I mean by that? Well, the Bible says there's a way which seemeth right unto a man, but the ends thereof are the ways of death. And there was a fellow by the name of Saul. Now, he was a guy that never broke his conscience, very religiously minded guy who had studied at the greatest preaching schools they had in the day. And yet, what does he say? Paul, who was Saul, says, I verily thought with myself I ought to do many things contrary to the name of Jesus, which some of that was killing Christians. But he was dead wrong, wasn't he? As he learns on the road to Damascus in Acts chapter 9. Many are not going to be saved because they won't repent. Jesus said, I tell you, except you repent, change your lifestyle. We have many today who are living a lifestyle that's absolutely abominable and ungodly and has been condemned in the patriarchal age, the Mosaical age, and in the Christian age. And yet they're saying, we're not going to stop living in this lifestyle. You're going to accept us. Not only are you going to accept us, we're going to demand that the courts accept us. We're going to demand that you actually put us in the pulpits in some places. And, of course, I'm talking about homosexuality. They don't think it's something to be repented of. Yet the Bible speaks over and over again. Some are going to be lost because they will not repent. Many are not going to be saved. And I think the most rough of them all, neglect. Just neglect. Not going to look at it this way or that way. I need to check into that. I need to do that. How many of us have started projects, and you're really into it, and then all of a sudden you're like, The next thing you know, it's been a couple years and you hadn't any food with it. You see, many are going to be lost on the day of judgment simply because they never took the time. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 3 says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, the salvation of your soul, folks? I'm talking about where you are going to spend eternity. The most important thing that it's ever going to happen to you. And the Hebrew writer says, how can we escape that? Which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, confirmed to them that heard him. We have the New Testament. We can read it today. And yet, neglect. And it's so easy to do. It is so easy to neglect something. Just keep putting it off. I'm going to get through that. And next thing you know, I think of Felix. He brings Paul, wants to hear him preach, and Paul lays it on. And as he reasoned of righteousness and temperance, of which two things Felix did not have, and then think about judgment where Felix says, I'm going to have to stand before the God of heaven and give an account of the things that Felix trembled. Literally, his bones shook, and he answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call thee. As far as we know, Felix never did that. You see, even though he was really shook up, and even though he said, man, I need to do something about this, he left out the building and had lunch at the Cracker Barrel, and the next thing you know, he just forgot about it, just neglected it. It's easy to do. Even though we may be heavily motivated, we may be very excited about a message and say, man, this is something I need to deal with, it's very easy just to simply let it go. Are you saved? Think about that, friends, brethren. Have you obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ? Are you walking in the light if you've done that? Have you left your first love? Are you saved? No reason. Don't leave this building without Jesus to be able to walk with him hand in hand. If you've never obeyed the gospel, the Bible's clear on how you do that. You have to come to an understanding that Jesus is the Christ through reading the Bible, through hearing the Bible preached. Once you believe that that is the case, you need to repent. Change your mind. Say, you know what? I'm not going to do that no more. I'm going to quit going that way. I'm going to change mine. I'm going to start walking how God would have me to walk. And yes, I am going to confess his name before men that I believe that he is the Christ, the Son of God. And submit yourself to baptism wherein the Bible tells us your sins will be washed away. You'll be added to the church. If we can help you at all in any way, we encourage you to come. As together we stand and sing.
I am resolved, O Lord.